Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here. We're going to be talking about Deuteronomy 28, the prophecies. How do they apply today, or are they prophecies at all? Do they apply today to the Negro scattered worldwide via the transatlantic slave trade? Today, we're going to talk about some stuff. We're going to bring it out. Shout out to Brother Jesher Stevens. He brought this source out. And I saw it in the Biblical Rumble Room, and there's quite the conversation going on around it. And so I decided to go ahead and do a video and post it up so that everybody can get in on this conversation. Anybody that's not part of the Rumble Room, Biblical Rumble Room, shout out to Pat Crescino, go join the Biblical Rumble Room. But before we get to that, if you guys want to support, you can do so in the Super Chat. Click the dollar sign and you can support via Super Chat whenever we're live. Later on, when Super Things get activated, you could do that too. If you don't have a copy of Undeniable, please grab your copy. You can find it on barnesandnoble.com, amazon.com, Full Color Evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. When you're tired of arguing with people who claim we take it out of context, or we're not reading the verses right, or we're ignorant, you know, the slave age arguing, or the slave age reasoning, or the slave age doctrine that black people are ignorant. You guys will hear that scenario running among people who call themselves Christians, but unfortunately, mostly from black Christians who have been indoctrinated and brainwashed by their cult. So if you're tired of arguing, just show the pictures. Undeniable, Full Color Evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. And lastly, today's episode is brought to you by the Royal Judas. If you guys don't have a pair yet, the link will be in the description or the comments. If they're in the comments, it'll be pinned to the top. So if you don't have your pair of Royal Judas, make sure you grab those. All right, we're going to get into this. Make sure you like this video. Thumbs up this video and subscribe. Share this video after it's over. So a while back, I gave you guys the Israel Slavery End Times and the Second Coming topical reference chart. We're version 3.0. Version 4.0 is coming soon. If you don't have your free copy of this, go to the link in the description and the link in the comments and make sure you download this free chart. Now, it's going to help you weed through the Bible. It connects the verses and everything to do with Israel's slavery, end times, and the second coming. So, moving forward with this study. Now, the reason this has grabbed my attention at this particular time is because there's a lot of discussion going on. We know that the urban apologists, not all of them, but that subsection, the cult that you guys know of, they have steadily and intentionally pushed a campaign of outright deception. They have pushed a slander, smear, campaign of lies, whatever you want to call this, that they're doing. They have acted deceitfully and intentionally, and let's not forget that Abu still chooses to associate with them. I know some people want to try to stick up for Abu and make excuses for Abu, but he is choosing to associate with people who have intentionally lied. He goes on their channel still and makes attacks towards us. He defends their position after they are caught lying. We've seen this, but this ain't about Abu. This is about the rest of them. The rest of them have intentionally deceived believers. They claim that the teaching that Deuteronomy 28 applies to black people taken in the transatlantic slave trade just came around with the camps. You guys have heard Alton Johnson, the false teacher, teaching that this is camp doctrine, or as he likes to say in the chat, leaky camp doctrine. So when you hear terms like that, what they're doing is they're trying to push a narrative of deception. And when you do that, and the Most High has a truth he is bringing forward, not trying to bring forward, because he will do all his pleasure. All you got to do is read the book. He'll do whatever he wants to do. And when you have liars who try to oppose a move of the Most High, they will constantly end up with egg on their face. They said there was no evidence at all whatsoever. They were so sure of that, or so they claim. Maybe they knew the whole time. Maybe this campaign of deception coming from so-called Christians has been intentional from the beginning. They said there was no evidence, knowing full well there was. And why do I say they know full well there was? Because when the conversation shifted and there was too much evidence to continue their false narrative, and I'm picking my words very carefully. I know exactly what I'm saying. So when people go back and make this video and say, listen to how he's talking and he's got to do this because he's a leader, just know and understand that I'm choosing my words very, very carefully and intentionally. These people are deceivers. So they said there was no evidence. The evidence piled up. And then they came back and said, well, it's true that there were Israelites in West Africa, but they were white. Well, let's pause there for a second. Because you said there was no evidence. And so now it becomes time to apologize to the people for getting it wrong. And if you don't apologize to the people, you are a liar and a deceiver. There's a difference between a mistake and getting information wrong and then lying and deceiving. It becomes lying and deceit. And you can lie by omission when you leave out information and you say, hey, there's no evidence. These people are crazy. They're making it up. They're trying to appropriate culture. They're stealing other people's culture. This is what was said about us from people who call themselves Christians. And then without any explanation or apology, they switch from no evidence to, well, you guys have the evidence right. You guys are just talking about the wrong color people. But which is it? Is there no evidence or is there evidence of Israelites in West Africa? So then we address the topic of white Israelites in West Africa. And lo and behold, we find a source that says they were albinos and that the natives referred to the albinos as white people. And so then without explanation, suddenly people are off of the white Jews in West Africa and now admitting that there were Israelites in West Africa. But hold on, what happened to the apology to the people for saying that these people were white and that we had the information wrong? Where's the apology? Where's the acknowledgement that you lied to people? Or let's not even say lied. Let's say, where's the apology to the people for getting the information wrong? And when you fail to apologize and you omit that part, that's when it turns into a lie. So now the conversation shifted to, okay, there were Israelites all in West Africa. Why didn't you start there? Why did you start lying to people saying there's no evidence? So there's either one of two things possibly going on. And I want y'all to tag Brother Berean in this. Please go to Brother Berean's channel and tag him in this because we need answers from all of these people. Did you know there was evidence of Israelites in West Africa years ago when this all started, and many of them, not Berean himself, but I want Berean to get answers from the people on his channel. Did they know that there was evidence of Israelites in West Africa before they started this campaign of lies to try to deceive people into thinking that Israelites were just making this stuff up? Because the original position was there's no evidence for it. And some people are still trying to run with that narrative, even though we have all agreed, Garfield, we've all agreed that, yes, there were Israelites in West Africa. And even coming down until recently, shout out to G-Con for being honest about this. Even recently, G-Con has said himself, yes, he agrees that there were slaves on those ships. Faithful to God has said he believes that there were Israelite slaves on those ships. So how many more people in the UA that have been against this from the beginning? How many more people in the UA believed that there were Israelites on those slave ships from the beginning? And if they didn't believe it then, why haven't they come up with an explanation as to why they believe it now? Why aren't they sharing those sources? I'll tell you why. Because they're getting those sources from me. They're getting those sources from Benaya Israel. They're getting those sources from Teo Ministries and Pastor Kelly. As much as they don't want to admit it, they're getting all their information from Israelites. And if I left anybody out that's sharing information, my apologies, Brother Tazara. Let me see who else. We got Genesis 49ers out there putting out information on the DNA. We got everybody out there putting in work. And yet they don't want to give us credit for the work we've put in for them because they seem incapable of putting in this work for themselves. Why am I going through all of this? Because I want to show you guys the shift. And there's another shift about to take place, another shift in conversation. See, a lot of y'all question why I'm over on Berean's channel, but I've been forcing the conversation forward. even if they don't realize what's happening, I've been forcing the conversation forward. Because when I started addressing them, they were saying that there's no evidence of Israelites in West Africa. And guess what? I kept pushing them on it, pushing them on it. And now, not only do they admit there's Israelites in West Africa, now they're saying there's a belief that there were Israelites on board those ships. So the conversation has been pushed from no evidence to, yes, they were on the ships. And so even though they readily admit that there were Israelite slaves on the ships during the transatlantic slave trade, which is the only worldwide slavery we know of in history, and if we're wrong, they certainly aren't in a rush to bring forth the evidence of another worldwide slave trade, because we've been asking them to show us and they won't do it. They can't do it. So now they will say Deuteronomy 28, which mentions worldwide slavery, and the biblical prophecies, which mention worldwide slavery, can't possibly apply to those Israelites from West Africa that were on the ships that took part in the only worldwide slavery that we know of. So you have to ask yourself, do these people who call themselves Christians, I call myself a Christian too, but these other people who call themselves Christians, do they really believe the word of God, or are they playing believers? Are they just pretending to be believers? These are questions we now all have to ask, because now they have put their integrity at jeopardy. And I'm gonna show you guys some evidence. Again, shout out to Brother Jesher Stevens for bringing this source. So we have to ask. We have heard, many of us growing up in the Christian church, that we're living in the last days, the end times. Well, when I read about the end times in Joel 3, Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 13, and the book of Revelation, I see judgment. I see judgment upon the nations. Joel 3 specifically mentions judgment because of the slavery of Israel. Luke 21 specifically mentions that Israel will be led captive into all nations. And Christ says that these things must happen, so the things that are written must be fulfilled. And the things that are written at his time was the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, we have Deuteronomy, and in Deuteronomy, we have chapter 28. This is about Deuteronomy chapter 28, by the way. Again, make sure y'all hit the thumbs up button. So now, I know this is a long introduction, but there are some things that have to be addressed before we go into this. And let me remind you that the deceivers out there are saying that it's leaky camp doctrine, that the messianics are getting their doctrine from the camps. That's another narrative they're running with, because they're liars and deceivers. Many of us have gotten our doctrine from the Christian church. And so we looked at Deuteronomy 28. I have a full series called Beyond Deuteronomy 28, where I've gone through and broken down the history of the transatlantic slave trade and went line by line through the curses. Go watch the series. Line by line through the curses with historical documentation to prove everything that I was saying. And so now that the conversation has been forced onto the slave ships, I'm going to force the conversation forward again. Again, shout out to Brother Jesher Stevens. He is playing a major role in us forcing this conversation forward. So what is the agenda behind these people? Why are they speaking on history if they clearly have no understanding of history? See, they want to run the scenario that we take things out of context, or we can't read, or we're misinterpreting things, or we're falsifying history, when in reality, it's them. They are ignorant of history. They have no idea what they're talking about. What they do is they form an opinion before they hear the matter out. And you have some ignorant people on Berean TV. I'm not talking about Berean. But you have, it was one specific ignorant person on Berean TV talking about he hasn't done the research. He don't know anything about it. But there's no way you can ever convince him because it doesn't make sense. That is probably the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. Probably along the lines of the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. I haven't done any research. I don't know anything about it. But you can't convince me of anything I don't already believe and haven't made up. Because we know at this point, they're just making it up as they go. So let's move forward. Hit that thumbs up button for me if y'all have not hit the thumbs up button. So we're going to start here. Again, shout out to Brother Jesher Stevens, because I believe in people giving people their credit when credit is due. Universal history Americanized. One more time. Universal history Americanized, or a historical view of the world from the earliest records to the year 1808. So we know this covers a time period up to 1808, even though, as you can see, it's not published until 1819. So now, let me finish reading this title. A historical view of the world from the earliest records to the year 1808, with a particular reference to the state of society, literature, religion, and form of government in the United States of America, Volume 1. So now we have a time frame. 214 years ago. It covers a time period from the earliest records to the year 1808. So the latest this goes up to is 214 years ago. Why is that important? Because there are certain people running with the scenario that this belief has not been around for a whole 100 years, and that the camps made it up. They will tell you the camps came around in 1960. But what I'm about to show you is around prior to 1808, and it's coming from a European. Why is that important? So when these people get out here saying that it's leaky camp doctrine, you'll know that they are liars and deceivers. Because if somebody has not done the thorough research, they shouldn't even be speaking on the subject. Proverbs says, "He who answers a matter before hearing it, it's a folly and a shame unto them." So if you don't know the information, stop spreading false information, stop false teaching people, stop making definitive statements as if you're right when you're not, Kevin G. Alton Johnson. All of these ignorant black believers, or so-called believers, because I don't think they're believers anymore, I think they're deceivers, and I think they're doing it on purpose at this point, because every time they open their mouth, the Most High reveals new information that shuts them down. And all they can do is do damage control. So let's make them do some damage control this time. So again, universal history, Americanized, or historical view of the world from the earliest records to the year 1808, with a particular reference to the state of society, literature, religion, and form of government in the United States of America. So one of their objections to Deuteronomy 28 is that it couldn't have meant the Americas because they didn't know of the Americas at the time. Does that sound like something a believer would say? Or does that sound like something someone who doesn't understand or believe the Bible would say? They will tell you God created the heaven and the earth. They will tell you Jesus is God in the flesh. They will tell you God is all-knowing. So if Jesus is God in the flesh and God is all-knowing, that would make Christ all-knowing. But then they're saying Christ didn't know about the Americas, because he's the one that made the statement in Luke 21:24. That they would be led captive into all nations. So maybe some of these Christians need to explain to us, is Christ all-knowing or not? Did he create the world, or does he not know about the Americas? You can't have both. Or do you believe that God is still learning like G-Con? Are y'all a bunch of open theists who won't admit in public that you're really open theists and that you don't believe that Christ knew everything, even though you claim he's the creator of heaven and earth? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:1 through, I think it's whatever verse, 3, 4, 5, up in there. They have some explaining to do. The prophets in the Old Testament, what does it matter whether or not they knew about America if the prophecies are coming from God, the creator of heaven and earth and all things in them? Are you telling us that God didn't know about the Americas? See, something is wrong with the doctrine over there, and there is a spirit of ignorance over the black church. So let me go ahead and start reading. Because this right here is just one piece of evidence. We're going to dig more into this. See, now we know that the information exists. And so now we can chase it down. And now we can start finding more evidence to support this and expose these liars and deceivers. So now we're going to read from page 401 to the top of page 407. I'm going to stop and make a little commentary in between. And we're going to point some things out. But again, this is from previous records up till 1808, and it was published in 1819, which means, again, This is 240, it goes up to 214 years before today. So the next time you hear somebody say this is leaky camp doctrine and that it started with the camps, just understand you're talking to a liar and a deceiver and someone who has not thoroughly done the research, nor are they interpreting scripture properly. Because if they're going to say they're interpreting scripture properly, they need to go debunk all these Europeans who are agreeing with us on how to interpret this scripture. All right, y'all, hit that thumbs up button. Patreon.com/Dante Fortson before I forget. And Cash App is #BHITB. So page 401. I'm going to have the link in the description so you guys can go through and read this whole source yourself. Because people like to say Dante doesn't read the whole sources. We're not reading whole books on here. So again, read the sources yourself. So starting at the top of page 401, the preservation. This is talking about Israelites, Jews. Now, the author may not agree on who the people are. However, he does point out some interesting things about the way they interpreted Deuteronomy 28 up until at least 1808. The preservation of this extraordinary people during their calamitous dispersion exhibits the faithfulness of the deity in fulfilling his gracious promise that when they are in the land of their enemies, he will not cast them away, nor destroy them utterly. And I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee. Though I make a full end of all the nations whither I have scattered thee, yet I will not make a full end of thee, but will correct thee in measure. The care of divine providence. I used to go to, that was actually the elementary school I went to out here in Vegas, Divine Providence. The care of divine providence is wonderfully displayed in saving the outcast of Israel from utter extermination while groaning under the most furious intolerance. Most black people can relate to this. Those that can't, I can't say nothing about those that can't. Everybody has their own experiences, but we know what we've experienced, and nothing they can say will change that. Though, from the destruction of Jerusalem to the 17th century, let me pause right there. If you guys go back and listen to the last study I did, I talked about 70 AD. They like to say that the end time started in 70 AD and will last until the Messiah comes. So now we're getting another time frame. This is why I tell you guys time frames are important to get from these people, because they will try to slither out if you don't. Though from the destruction of Jerusalem to the 17th century, so that's the 1600s, there are few countries in which they have not been successively banished, recalled, and again exiled. Yet they have never been banished from one country without finding an asylum in another. The Jews are, as was foretold, dispersed over the habitable globe. Did that happen to us or not? See, they're trying to create a scenario in which they can, everybody else can say they're Israelites except for the Negro. But we know that the transatlantic slave trade was worldwide. And again, if it was not, find us another one. If you can't find us another one, you must submit to the fact that this is the only one that applies, and therefore you are living right in the middle of Bible prophecy. You're just not a believer, so you don't want to believe it. The Jews are, as was foretold, dispersed over the habitable globe, being themselves the depositories of those oracles in which their unbelief and consequent sufferings are clearly predicted. What clearly predicted? Had the Jews been all converted, we should have had none but suspected witnesses. Had they been all destroyed, we should have had no witnesses at all. The exact accomplishment of our Savior's prediction respecting the destruction of their city and temple and the calamities they have endured since their dispersion have furnished every age with the strongest arguments for the truth of the Christian religion. Wait, they're saying what's happening to Israel is the strongest argument for the truth of the Christian religion, and yet we have some Christians opposing what's coming to light. Why is that? Are they really believers? We have to start questioning these people now. We have to question their whole belief system. They want to say everybody else is in heresy and error and all this. No. The history don't add up to what y'all teaching. The DNA ain't adding up to what y'all teaching. The doctrine ain't adding up to what y'all teaching. The actions don't add up. One of the great designs of their being preserved and continued a distinct people appears to be that their singular destiny might confirm the divine authority of the gospel, which they reject. And some Israelites do reject that. And he's not talking about Negroes, but I'm pointing out the similarities of what he's saying to Negro history. Those taken in the transatlantic slave trade, the descendants of those taken in the transatlantic slave trade. And that they might strengthen the faith of others in those sacred truths to which they refuse to yield their own consent. So wait, is that Israel being a light unto the world? Even though they reject it, the history is still pointing people to the truth. And you'll hear some of them say, well, how can knowing who you are lead people to Christ? But this author, who wrote up to 1808, seems to believe that the history and knowing who these people are does lead people to the faith. So how is it that the black church can't see that? It's because they're spiritually blinded, arrogant, and ignorant all at the same time, and yet they think they're right. The future conversion of the Jews has been the subject of various works published in Europe in the present and the two last centuries, so at least the 1600s. Many pious and learned men have supposed that they will not only be converted to the Christian religion, but restored to Palestine and placed in a state more splendid and glorious than ever. Oh, so there were land promises still to come. This was being taught by Europeans in Europe, right here. It says in Europe, in the present, and the last two centuries. So since the 1600s at least, they've been teaching that the Israelites will be converted and believe in the Messiah and be restored to Palestine, the land, and placed in a state more splendid and glorious than ever. Chuck Missler taught this, and a bunch of other Europeans taught this. So now if it goes to the two centuries prior to 1808, that would mean at least till the 1600s. And it is now 2021, so that means the doctrine is at least 421 years old, give or take a few years. So when you hear people on Berean's channel saying that this doctrine didn't come around to the last 100 years and it started with the camps, ask yourself, why are these people lying to you? Because this document right here goes up to 1808 and it says they were teaching it for at least 200 years prior to that. So for over 400 years, there's that number again, over 400 years, over 400 years this has been taught, not just in the last 100 years. We're gonna force this conversation forward. The prophecies, what prophecies? We're going to talk about that. However, which are alleged in order to prove the return of the Hebrew nation to Palestine, can only be completely explained by the events which accomplished them. But the sacred page has clearly opened a source of consolation to those who are anxiously waiting for the redemption of Israel. An inspired apostle has assured us that the Jews, the natural branches of the olive tree, the natural branches of the olive tree. Didn't Paul say something about boasting against the natural branches? And yet we see that many, not all, many in the black church, that's all they do. And then we have those outside of the black church. They have this weird obsession with us. They have a weird obsession with our history, what we believe in, what we're doing, what we're talking about, just like in slave times. The overseers always wanted to make sure the Negroes didn't gather and talk without one of them present. They wanted to know what's going on, to the point that they forbid Negro gatherings in many states under penalty of death, imprisonment, fines, beatings, all kind of stuff, depending on where you were in the country. But here we go. We're about to get to the good stuff. We're about to get to the medicine in the white bottle, as Brother Berean calls it. This is some good medicine in the white bottle. Brother Berean, if you're watching, which I know you are, pay attention to this. An inspired apostle has assured us that the Jews, the natural branches of the olive tree, though now broken off by unbelief, will be grafted in again and participate with the Gentiles in the blessings resulting from faith in the Messiah. A review of the preceding history of the Jews exhibits to the attentive reader in such a striking manner the exact accomplishment of the famous prophecy of Moses, Deuteronomy 28. Now, these are Roman numerals. XX, X is 10, so you have 10, 20, V is 5, and III, that's 3. So 20 plus 5 plus 3 equals 28. Deuteronomy 28. They're calling it a prophecy in the 1800s. And the two centuries prior to that. A prophecy. Let me say it again, a prophecy. So when you hear these guys out here saying that Deuteronomy 28 isn't prophecy, they're lying. We've gone through Deuteronomy 28. Watch the whole series beyond Deuteronomy 28. So I'll read it one more time. A review of the preceding history of the Jews exhibits to the attentive reader in such a striking manner the exact accomplishment of the famous prophecy of Moses, Deuteronomy 28, that this chapter appears to be a correct miniature picture of the leading features in their history drawn by the pencil of inspiration. The devout must feel an augmented veneration for the sacred scriptures while they observe the complete agreement of ancient prophecies with events more than 2,000 years subsequent or 2,000 years later. Skepticism and infidelity must be confounded by seeing the history of succeeding ages so accurately delineated in predictions uttered 10 centuries before the birth of the Savior. So they considered it to be prophecy. Hold on. We're going to keep going. Among many predictions or prophecies in which this coincidence is strikingly evident. So they think this is evident even though y'all don't see it. The following deserve to be noticed. Among other awful denunciations against the Jewish nation, Moses declares Deuteronomy 28:29. Thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore. And again, the author doesn't necessarily agree that Negroes are the people, but we know that this lines up with the experience of descendants of slaves in America and scattered all over the world. So now he's quoting Deuteronomy 28:29. Thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore. Numerous instances occur of the cruel oppressions and pillages this devoted race have suffered in England, France, Germany, and Spain, in the East, as well as in Europe. They have been continually subjected to heavy fines and impositions. So wait, they didn't think this had already been fulfilled. So when you hear people get up on these channels and say Deuteronomy 28 was already fulfilled, and then you ask them for the historical evidence and they can't give it to you, this is why. Because even into the 1800s, they still believed that this stuff was prophecy being fulfilled in their time. Tell the truth, shame the devil. Keep telling Berean, tell the truth, shame the devil. In the East, as well as in Europe, they have been continually subjected to heavy fines and impositions. In different countries, they have been often forced to redeem their lives by vast sums extorted from them. Did sovereigns want pecuniary assistance to carry on their wars? The Jews were compelled to give up their riches. A massacre was generally the prelude to a plunder, as we have seen in various parts of Europe. When banished from England in the reign of Edward I, their estates, which were confiscated, brought immense sums to the crown. When Philip Augustus expelled them from France, he confiscated their estates, yet he soon after recalled his oppressed people to fleece them again. They have almost everywhere paid for liberty to exist. Y'all ever heard of the black tax? If you haven't, go ahead and do some historical research. If you don't know about the towns after slavery, they required black people to pay a tax if they were not married. And on top of that, they weren't allowed to marry in certain states. So you're black, you have to be married, or you have to pay a tax, but it's against the law for you to get married in certain states. They have almost everywhere paid for liberty to exist. The great lawgiver of the Hebrew nation also declared, thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people. Let me see. Sons right here. This is Deuteronomy 28:32. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thine hand. That's Deuteronomy 28. This is a European author. This isn't a camp. So clearly, they have come to a crossroads. Not the Europeans. I'm talking about the people who call themselves Christians who oppose this information. They have come to a crossroads. Those who claim this is leaky camp doctrine, they either have to hold the position that these Europeans over 200 years ago were teaching leaky camp doctrine, which they say is only about 100 years old, or they have to admit this is not leaky camp doctrine. It did not start with the camps, but it started with Europeans. Maybe before them. We know at least 16th century. It says 1800s, but it says and the two centuries before it. So at least between the 1600s and the 1800s, this was a belief and this was being taught, like I said, over 400 years ago. Let me start here. The great lawgiver of the Hebrew nation also declared, thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people. How exactly has this prophecy been fulfilled in several countries, especially in Spain and Portugal? Uh-oh. Ain't that been the topic of discussion for a while now? Spain and Portugal. And we know that Portugal ultimately deported the children into West Africa. Oh, let's keep reading. In the former of these kingdoms, Spain, the Council of Toledo decreed that the children of the Jews should be taken from them and educated in the Christian faith. Oh, they're splitting up families? All these people had a problem with the Republicans splitting up families, but we know it didn't start with the Republicans. This is American tradition carried over from Spain and Portugal. Let's keep reading. In the latter, Portugal, when they were expelled, all under 14 years of age were forcibly detained to be baptized. In the frenzy and despair of the wretched parents at parting with their children, we contemplate the accomplishment of another prophetic denunciation. They shall be mad for the sight of their eyes, which they shall see. Verse 34. Let's go verify verse 34 in Deuteronomy. So that thou shall be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see. We covered all this stuff. But they say we crazy. We reading it wrong, right? In the frenzy and despair of the wretched parents, for parting with their children, we contemplate the accomplishment of another prophetic denunciation. They shall be mad for the sight of their eyes, which they shall see. Verse 34. And into what madness, fury, and desperation have they not been excited by the cruel extortions and oppressions which they have undergone? Notice he ain't mentioned no skin color yet. And again, I'm not saying that the author agrees that they are Negroes. I'm just pointing out how they were interpreting Deuteronomy 28 from the 1600s till at least 1808, according to the words in this book. After mentioning the oppression and barbarous cruelty the Jews were compelled to endure, and the madness subsequent upon their extreme sufferings, Moses further declares, verse 37, thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, whither the Lord shall lead thee. Let's go verify that in 37. We're going to verify this, everything. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, whither the Lord shall lead thee. Why is he interpreting it as a present thing in the 1800s when this book was published? And yet they're telling us that we can't interpret it in the present as continuation. And we also cited Spain and Portugal, and they said we were liars and that we're making up the history. And now we have Europeans saying the same thing about Spain and Portugal. But where did we get it from? We got it from European sources. And yet they want to call this leaky camp doctrine. Right here. How exactly has this prophecy been fulfilled upon this happy race who have been a byword ever since their dispersion? We heard the N-word plenty of places. In various countries of the East, as well as in Europe, they have been subjected to disgraceful distinctions and condemned to wear outwardly the badges of their abject state, and everywhere exposed to the insults of the vilest populace. I'm not even going to get into that painting, but y'all remember the painting discussion and who was wearing what? And this right here says they were condemned to wear outwardly the badges of their abject state and everywhere exposed to the insults of the vilest populace. Y'all can't read. Y'all are ignorant. Y'all are stupid. Y'all are taking it out of context. Y'all need to get some education. We hear from these people who call themselves Christians. Tell me the difference between what this European author is talking about in the 1800s and how they're behaving right now. There's no difference. We need to put Christianity under a microscope. Not just Christianity itself, but more so the people who identify themselves as Christians, because somebody identifying themselves as something has no bearing on the actual system itself. And these people call themselves believers, and yet it's starting to seem like they are more so deceivers. If they don't know the history, they should just keep their mouth shut and let those that do teach it. If they don't know the history, they should stop lying to people and misleading people. Tell people right off you haven't done the research and you just want to give an opinion on it. Don't say, well, this is a fact and this isn't true and you guys are taken out of context if you ain't did the research. Otherwise, you're a deceiver and a false teacher, and we're just going to make it be known what it is. I'm not going to sugarcoat any of this. They have been treated as of a different species. Anybody remember the book, The Negro, a Beast? Anybody remember us being defined as three-fifths human? Anybody remember the fact that the Voting Rights Act only temporarily gave Negroes the right to vote, even until this day? It's only 30 years at a time. Or 25 years at a time that we have the right to vote. And people are talking about they ain't oppressed and everything is equal. No. What other people on this planet? Forget the planet. What other people in America have to have their right to vote re-voted for every 25 years? And don't forget that when the Voting Rights Act was passed, it was only meant to be for a period of 5 years, one more election. And then they extended it. And then they extended it again. But some of y'all don't know that history. You think that the Voting Rights Act of 64, 65? Y'all think the Voting Rights Act was permanently giving us the right to vote? No, it temporarily gave us the right to vote. Let's keep reading. They have been treated as of a different species and in several parts of Europe subjected to the same toll with those animals which they abhor. Christians, Mahometans, and pagans have agreed in abusing, vilifying, and persecuting them. Oh, that don't sound like the Negro experience to y'all? We know what's going on. The Most High is bringing out the truth regardless of what these devils want to do. And yes, I say y'all are devils when you are sitting up there lying to people and the history keeps coming out proving you wrong in every direction and you go into damage control and try to create new lies. See, I wonder where they're going to be pushed to this time. We've already pushed them from no evidence to yes, there is evidence, and Israelites came over here on the slave ships. They don't want to say how many came over because they know once they do, it's a wrap. But now we got this. And so now the Deuteronomy 28 conversation is going to change. It's going to be forced to change. And every time they bring up Deuteronomy 28, I want y'all to bring up this source right here. The sacred writer, talking about Moses, proceeds in delineating the dreadful outline of their miseries and declares, verse 59, the Lord will make thy plagues wonderful and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues of long continuance. Let's go to verse 59. I'm pretty sure he's a little different. The Lord will make thy plagues wonderful and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues and of long continuance and sore sickness and of long continuance. There we go. The calamities they have endured were indeed the greatest which the world ever witnessed. Again, not saying he's talking about the Negro, but we know what it is. We know our history. Ever since the destruction of Jerusalem, 70 AD, that number is going to keep coming up, 70 AD. Ever since the destruction of Jerusalem, they have been outcast from society, subsisting amidst contempt and persecution. For 18 centuries, the nations of the earth have been treading underfoot the remains of Israel. What nation ever suffered so much and yet continued so long? Is that not the story of the Negro? What nation ever suffered so much, continued so long? All you have to do is go read the history of the transatlantic slave trade and what was happening prior to that. As the author mentioned, Spain and Portugal, we have lots of research on that. The chief diversity in their condition has arisen from the various kinds of miseries to which they have been subjected. in Christendom. Notice how the author keeps naming Christians. They have been despised, calumniated, oppressed, banished, executed, and burned. I'm going to read that one more time. In Christendom, they have been despised, calumniated. I need to look that word up right there. Calumniated, oppressed, banished, executed, and burned. The tyranny exercised against them has been as capricious as it was cruel. In France, they have been at one time compelled to assume the mask of Christianity to save themselves from a cruel death. At another, the estates even of those who renounced Judaism were confiscated. This is what I said on Berean's channel the other day, that a lot of people were forced into conversions, whether it was Islam or Christianity. At one period, they have been banished through superstition. At another, recalled through avarice, greed. A writer of their own nation has observed, it seems as if they were allowed to survive the destruction of their own country, only to stand as the constant object of the most shocking injustice, as a mark for the insulting finger of scorn, as a sport to the most inveterate hatred. In verse 53 and 57 of the same 28th chapter of Deuteronomy, see, the author repeats it. This third time he mentioned that it's Deuteronomy 28. In verse 53 and 57 of the same 28th chapter of Deuteronomy, there is a prediction of a famine leading to horrid practices never heard of before or since. Now, we're about to get to this stuff because I pulled some of this out for the transatlantic slave trade. Go watch my series, Beyond Deuteronomy 28. You guys will see some of the evidence presented there. Accordingly, in the last siege of Jerusalem by the Romans, there was a most terrible famine in the city, of which Josephus saith that women snatched the food out of the very mouths of their husbands and sons of their fathers and mothers of their infants, and that in every house, if there appeared any semblance of food, a battle ensued, snatching away the miserable provisions of life. So literally are the words of Moses fulfilled, verse 54. The man's eye shall be evil toward his brother and towards the wife of his bosom and toward his children, because he has nothing left him in the siege and in the straitness wherewith thine enemies shall distress thee and all thy gates. And in like manner, the woman's eye shall be evil toward the husband of her bosom, toward her son, and towards her daughter. But wait a minute. Let me remind you that many of these so-called Christians are saying that Deuteronomy 28 is not prophecy, and that it, and those that do say it was prophecy say it was already fulfilled. We have to look at it in context and what it meant to them. That's not how prophecy works. Everything prophecy is future events until we start applying it to the Negro. Then now all of a sudden, prophecy ain't prophecy. Black ain't black. Bronze ain't bronze. You aren't reading it right. You can't use the Bible to prove you're Israel. You're not allowed to use the curses to prove you're Israel. And you have some of the most ignorant people, like Faithful to God and Kevin G. Some of the most ignorant, uneducated, low IQ people. Usually you can identify them because they have a loud mouth and they like to overtalk everybody while they're trying to make a point. And they want to tell everybody else how ignorant they are and unlearned they are and call everybody else liars before they can finish their point. This is how you know when somebody's ignorant and unlearned, like Faithful to God and Kevin G. You have these people who are ignorant and unlearned and will say stupid stuff like, well, the only way you can apply those curses in Deuteronomy 28 to black people is if you already believe they apply to black people. That's dumb. Because anybody can read that that knows black history. I'm not talking about some ignorant outsider who ain't even black that wants to tell black people about our history and he don't even know his own history. I ain't talking about Kevin G. I'm talking about Faithful to God. You have these people that want to try to teach us about our history and they don't know anything about our history. But let me continue. The tender and, hold on, let me see. Let me go back just a little bit. Nay, it was expressly foretold. Prophesied that not only the men, but even the women shall eat their own children. Moses had foretold the same thing before in Leviticus 21:29. Let's go look at Leviticus 21:29. Let's go look at verse 29. I'm sorry. Oh, wait. Leviticus 20. Yeah, 21. 29. We're going to see. Well, we don't see a Leviticus 21. 29. So that might be a mistype. So this is why we go and check stuff. So let me see if we can find this. Where is it at? I know it's in Deuteronomy 28, but let's see if we can find. Nope. Let's see. Well, this right here is a misprint. Or maybe it's 21 and 29, chapters 21 and 29, but let's see. Nay, it was expressly foretold that not only the men, but the women shall eat their own children. Moses had foretold the same thing before in Leviticus 21, 29. Let's see. Eat. And let's see, children. Let's see here. Let's see if we can find it. Let's see. Deuteronomy 28:25, we know, or sorry, 28:55, so that he will not give any of them of the flesh of his children whom he shall eat, because he hath nothing left him in the siege and in the straitness wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in all thy gates. So we can verify it in there. Let's see if we find anything reference to eating children in Deuteronomy, I'm sorry, in Leviticus at all. We're gonna see. Well, so far we can't find it in Leviticus, as the author points out, but we do find it in Deuteronomy 28:55. So we're gonna keep going. This is why you have to vet these things. You can't just read them and be like, oh, well, they said this there. But you look up Deuteronomy 21. I'm sorry, Leviticus 21:29, and we don't see it there. So he said he repeats it in Deuteronomy 28:53. We just saw Deuteronomy 28:55. Let's go back and read a couple verses. We'll read 53 through 55. And thou shalt eat the fruit of thine own body, the flesh of thy sons and thy daughters, which the Lord thy God hath given thee, in the siege and in the straitness wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee, so that the man that is tender among you and very delicate, his eyes shall be evil toward his brother and toward the wife of his bosom and toward the remnant of his children, which he shall leave. So that he will not give to any of them the flesh of the children whom he shall eat, because he hath nothing left him in the siege and in the straitness wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in all thy gates. So now remember, typos happen, people misremember things, and proofreading, editing may not have been like they were back then. So this reference to Leviticus 21:29 is very likely a misprint or a misremembering of the other verse that they were referring to. He repeats it in Deuteronomy 28:53, and thou shalt eat the fruit of thine own body, the flesh of thy sons and of thy daughters, and more particularly verse 56. Let's read verse 56. The tender and delicate woman among you, which would not adventure to set her sole of her foot upon the ground for delicateness and tenderness, her eyes shall be evil toward her husband of her bosom and toward her son and toward her daughter. The tender and delicate woman among you, who would not adventure to set her sole of her foot upon the ground for delicateness and tenderness, she shall eat her children for one of all things, secretly in the siege and straitness wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in thy gates. Moses saith that she would do it secretly, and according to Josephus, here we go, when she had boiled and eaten half, she covered up the rest and kept it for another time. Interesting. According to Josephus, this did happen. According to my research that I shared, this also happened during the transatlantic slave trade, where they would kill people on board the ships and force the other people on board those ships to eat them when they ran out of food. So we had cannibalism going on. So exactly hath this prophecy been fulfilled. One would have thought that such distress and horror had almost transcended imagination, and much less was it supposable that any person could certainly have foreseen and foretold it. Again, they consider Deuteronomy 28 prophecy. So when they come and say it's leaky camp doctrine, they are lying. Verse 62, it is said, and ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for a multitude. Now there was in the last siege of Jerusalem by Titus an infinite multitude, saith Josephus, who perished by famine. Famine. Let me stop there for a second. If you do some research on the history of the United States specifically, you will find that in some parts of the South, black people were 50% of the population. And now we are told we're only about 14% of the population, maybe 13%, depending on some numbers. So how did we go from 50% at a certain point to 13 to 14% now? Left few in number, even though we know they took more than. So like, let me just point this out. We know how many people they took in the transatlantic slave trade. Some people estimate that over 100 million were taken and the majority of them died. Some people say the estimates are smaller. Some people say only like 10 to 12 million. Well, let's assume 10 to 12 million were taken in the transatlantic slave trade. We know they had breeding farms and we know that there were rapes. So children were being born. So now, if we do the math for 400 years, the population of America is roughly 400 million. 10% of that is 40 million. So 1% of that would be 4 million. So if you have 40 million and we're 14%, and 1% of 400 million is 4 million, you add that other 4. So 4 times 4 is 16 million. So if we're 14%, we should have roughly 56 million black people here. 12 million in. 12 million people over the course of 400 years has turned into 56 million. Those numbers sound like a lot until you realize that there has been a war waged on the Negro since the Negro landed in America. War through slavery, lynchings, abortions, probably the biggest reduction of our population comes through abortion. And who do we have to thank for abortions entering the community? The black church. Some of y'all don't like that. But if you go read Margaret Sanger's book, Margaret Sanger's plan was to infiltrate the community through the black church. But what people don't want to acknowledge is you don't go through the strongest point, you go through the weakest point to infiltrate something. And so they looked at the black community and said, the weakest point is the black church. If we get into the black church, these weak black ministers will help us push it to the rest of the community. That's how they sold abortion or mass genocide to the black community, through the weakness of the black church. Now y'all can say y'all did all this other stuff. Y'all did more for the black community and the Israelites, which is another lie. We know the Israelites were in the black church doing the work. Just because y'all don't want to claim Israel doesn't negate the work that the Israelites did while they were still a part of the black church. Now, if you don't want Israel to have credit for it, y'all got to stop taking credit for it too. Nobody gets credit for the work if the people who did the work don't get credit for it. But what y'all will take credit for is bringing abortion and mass genocide to the community. That's what y'all will take credit for. All right. So let's keep going. Verse 62, it is said, and ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for a multitude. Let's verify that. Verse 62, and ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for a multitude, because thou wouldest not obey the voice of the Lord thy God. Okay. So far, so good, except for that one instance with Leviticus 21:29. Now there was in the last siege of Jerusalem by Titus an infinite multitude, said Josephus, who perished by famine. He computes that during the whole siege, the number of those who were destroyed by that and by the war amounted to 1,100,000. The people being assembled in Jerusalem from all parts to celebrate the Passover, the same author hath given us an account of 1,240,499 destroyed in Jerusalem and in parts of Judea, besides 99,200 made prisoners. Indeed, there is not a nation upon the earth that is that has been exposed to so many massacres and persecutions. Now, if he's not talking about the Negro, I would put the transatlantic slave trade up against any of this information any day and point out that it matches. it matches what is predicted in the book of Deuteronomy or prophesied in the book of Deuteronomy. Their history abounds with them. They were to be carried into Egypt and sold for slaves at a very low price. Verse 68, and the Lord shall bring thee again into Egypt again with ships, and there you should be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. We all know this right here. We don't have to verify it, but we're going to verify it anyway. We know it's there. Now, we're going to look at his take on it. His take isn't necessarily the same as our take, but again, there are a lot of similarities. And again, doesn't mean he says that Negroes are the people. However, the history lines up. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships by the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again, and there you shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. And remember, they're running with this ridiculous scenario. I'm talking about some of the black Christians, not all, because not all black Christians are as dumb as the ones we've been dealing with. And I know some of y'all say that's mean to call them dumb. I don't know what else to call them at this point when they keep getting everything wrong and they keep lying. So maybe they're not being dumb. Maybe they're just deceptive. I don't know. Y'all can take y'all pick. It's either dumb or deception. They were to be carried into Egypt and sold for slaves. But wait, they were telling us that they were selling themselves into slaves. And yet in the 1800s, Europeans were teaching that Israel was supposed to be sold for slaves, carried into Egypt, sold for slaves. Not that they would sell themselves, this new doctrine. If we're going to talk about new doctrine, if we're going to talk about Johnny come lately doctrine, if we're going to talk about doctrine that's less than 100 years old, let's talk about this new doctrine of them selling themselves into slavery and nobody wanting to buy them. Call it out, Brother Berean. Call it out for what it is. It's new doctrine. It's more new than what y'all say the camp doctrine is. All right, so let's keep going. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. They had come out of Egypt triumphantly, but now they were returned thither as slaves. They had walked through the seas as dry land at their coming out, but now they should be carried thither in ships. This was a much safer way of conveying so many prisoners than sending them by land. It appears from Josephus that when Jerusalem was taken by Titus, he sent many of the captives who were above 17 years of age, bound to the works in Egypt. Those under 17 were sold, but so little care was taken of these captives that 11,000 of them perished for want. The markets were quite overstocked with them. So that Josephus says in another place, they were sold with their wives and children at the lowest price, there being so many to be sold, but few purchasers. Oh, wait, I thought they were trying to sell themselves. See, when you have too much supply and little demand, they only got lower prices for them. But see, these other guys who come along right now say, hey, they sold themselves into slavery and nobody would buy them. No, there were too many to sell into slavery. They were to be rooted out of their land, verse 63. And you shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. Let's see. Like I said, he doesn't 100% interpret it the way we do in every case, because many of us believe the Egypt to be America. And I do have that study coming up for you guys. And it shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good and multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you and to bring you to naught. And you shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. Sounds like they believe this is prophecy to me. They were indeed plucked from off their own land when the Romans took away their place and nation. Now, let me not get ahead of myself, but I do want to point out that worldwide slavery in Deuteronomy is often ignored by current people who call themselves believers and Christians. They want to stop at, oh, well, this happened right here. But remember, if we go back up to the numbers, let me go back up to the numbers before we get too far down. Remember where we are. We're on page 406. We'll come back down to that. Let's see here. The same author has given us a count of 1,240,499. So 1.4 million destroyed in Jerusalem and other parts of Judea, besides 99,200 made prisoners. So let's just round it up to 100,000, right? 100,000 were prisoners. Over 1.4 million were destroyed. Were they carried as a nation into Egypt? No, we only see 1/10 of the total number we just got was made slaves, and a majority of the number we got were killed. So this isn't the only imprisonment of the nation, because remember, they're going to be scattered into all the world. So back to page 406. Right here, and he's going to address this. They were indeed plucked from off their own land when the Romans took away their place and nation. But they were not only to be plucked from off their own land, but also to be dispersed into all nations. Verse 25, and thou shalt be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. And again, verse 64, and the Lord shall scatter thee among the people from one end of the earth even unto the other. So we're going to verify verses 25 and 64. I know this is taking a while, but we're going to verify everything. Everything that's said in these. 25. Let's go. And the Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and thou shalt be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. They said that ain't prophecy, right? No, they'll tell you, oh, they were sent back into Egypt. That ain't all kingdoms. Egypt is not all kingdoms. And then verse 64, and the Lord shall scatter thee among all people from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. Hit that thumbs up button if you haven't hit it already, and make sure you subscribe if you haven't already. We got more stuff coming for you guys. A lot more stuff. Let's keep going. And the Lord shall scatter thee among the people from one end of the earth even into the other. These words have been amply fulfilled since the dispersion of the Jews by the Romans. So since 70 AD, what people indeed have been scattered so far and wide as they? I would say the Negro through the transatlantic slave trade. And where is the nation which is a stranger to them, or to which they are strangers? They circulate through all parts where trade and money circulate, and are the brokers of the whole world. So we know who he's talking about. He's talking about the 1948 people. That's who he applies it to. However, we know that some of the stuff does not fit them. It does fit the Negro. And again, I said some. And we're gonna verify these Leviticus references here, since we found the other one wasn't on point. But though they should be so dispersed, yet they should not be totally destroyed, but still subsist as a distinct people, as Moses had before foretold in Leviticus 26:44. We're going to go to Leviticus 26:44. 26. Oh, looks like we got action on this one. And yet for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, where? The land of their enemies. Are we in the land of our enemies? Well, let's see. Were our ancestors kidnapped, split up, raped, beat, tortured, murdered by the people that live here? Yes, they were. Are their descendants still doing the same thing to many of our people, even though some of our people don't want to recognize it? Yes, they are. So we are in the land of our enemies, not saying that every single descendant of these people is an enemy, but there are enemies and it is their land. And yes, we are in the land of our enemies. How do we know? Because we're defined as 3/5 of a human. How do we know? Because a cop can murder one of us and get a paid vacation. That is a reward. Let me say it again. They can murder one of us and get a paid vacation. That is a reward, not a punishment. You can't tell me, oh, he murdered somebody, so he's been given paid administrative leave. What other job in the world can you murder people and get rewarded with a paid vacation? As if that's a punishment. You get to take the day off and you get money. Sounds like an incentive program to me. And yet for all that, Let me read verses 43. I'm just going to read verse 43 and 44 one more time. We're looking at 44 because of this. I want to read verse 43 and 44. Actually, I'm going to read 43 through 45. The land also shall be left of them and shall enjoy her Sabbaths. while she lieth desolate without them, and they shall accept the punishment of their iniquity, because even because they despised my judgments, and because their soul abhorred my statutes. And yet for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away. I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them or hate them, to destroy them utterly and to break my covenant with them, for I am the Lord their God. So God is not going to break the covenant, even though Israel broke the covenant. I said this before, God is not going to drop his end of the bargain because Israel broke theirs. He said, if you break yours, this is the part of the covenant I'm going to uphold. I'm going to do these things to you. And did they happen to the Negroes? Yes or no? And the answer is yes. Anybody who's honest and studied black history in its entirety knows that God kept his promise. But I will, for their sakes, remember the covenant of their ancestors, whom I brought forth out of the land of Egypt. So this is another thing happened. He's going to remember the covenant of their ancestors, whom he brought forth out of the land of Egypt in the sight of the heathen, that I might be their God. I am the Lord. These are the statutes and judgments and the laws which the Lord made between him and the children of Israel in Mount Sinai by the hand of Moses. Later on, we're going to see in Deuteronomy 29 that is the Moab covenant. And it's called a different covenant than this. But all this stuff is connected. And yet for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them, to destroy them utterly and to break my covenant with them. The Jewish nation, like the bush of Moses, hath been always burning but never consumed. And what a marvelous thing is it that after so many years, battles and sieges, after so many rebellions, massacres and persecutions, after so many years of captivity, slavery, and misery, they are not utterly destroyed. And though scattered among all nations, yet subsist as a distinct people by themselves. Where is anything comparable to this to be found in all the histories and in all the nations under the sun? Somebody got some explaining to do. Now, whether or not the author agrees that the Negro is part of the tribes of Israel, we know the history fits. And I'm going to read something else for y'all in the footnotes real quick to hear. I just want to read it and see what we find. But somebody got some explaining to do. People have been calling this leaky camp doctrine, and now it turns out the doctrine is over 200 years old. At minimal, actually 400 years old, because this book is written up to 1808, published in 1819, but it mentions that for two centuries prior to the writing of this book, this had been taught. And again, y'all can go through and read this source for yourself. The link is in the description. The link will be in the comments section as well. So for 400 years, this has been taught as prophecy, Deuteronomy 28. So somebody got some explaining to do when they call this leaky camp doctrine and saying that show evidence. If I recall, I could be wrong. Somebody says show evidence that this was taught before 100 years ago. Show evidence that this didn't come from the camps. They've been over there lying and lying and lying and lying because they don't know the history. They're speaking out of ignorance. Why would you trust somebody who speaks out of ignorance? It's time we start questioning their entire cult. What is their agenda? What is their motive? What is behind them lying to people about this history, telling people that this is new doctrine that they ain't never heard before? When we know now for a fact that this is at least 400 years old. At least 400 years old. Let me say it one more time. At least 400 years old. Shout out to Garfield. I got something coming for him too. Garfield ain't hit me up, by the way, for those of y'all who heard him ask me for that evidence of any slave claiming to be a descendant of Israel. And I mentioned to him that there is a text that mentions interrogation of slaves. I got something coming for him. He ain't hit me up. He said he's going to write down the date. I said, write it down, take a picture. Y'all know the rest. That was my exact quote. I ain't heard from Garfield yet. So I'm going to go ahead and put out the information in public, and Garfield can grab it from there and the link from there to the source. So let's read this footnote and we're going to wrap this up. Make sure y'all hit that thumbs up button. The preservation of the Jews is one of the most illustrious acts of divine providence. We living in prophecy, y'all. We are the living embodiment of prophecy. Our very existence is proof of the Most High and His word and His promises to be kept. Our very existence is proof that everything in that book is the word of God. And yet they want to try to destroy our credibility and our reputation. Why is that? Why are they fighting so hard against God? It's hard to kick against the pricks. Ain't that what he told Paul? Why persecutest thou me? Ain't that what he asked Paul? So the very people who are supposed to be a light unto the world, the very people who are supposed to be coming into the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I know all of y'all don't like using the name, and I know Christ ain't his last name. It's a title. But God ain't bound by language, and none of this matters anyway, because if you go to the book of Revelation, he's going to write a new name. He's going to reveal his new name. So all of the names y'all got, Yeshua, Yahweh, Yahweh, Jehovah, all of that, read the book of Revelation. He's going to reveal his new name. Let me say that one more time. His new name. So all these old names probably won't even matter no more. And some of y'all arguing about that. Anyway, the preservation of the Jews is one of the most illustrious acts of divine providence. They are dispersed among all nations, and yet they are not confounded with any. The drops of rain which fall, nay, the great rivers which flow into the ocean, are soon mingled and lost in the immense body of waters. The same in all human probability would have been the fate of the Jews. They would have been mingled and lost in the common mass of mankind, but on the contrary. Oh, but wait, hold on, let's pause right there. Aren't some of these black Christians teaching that Israel is everybody? They got dispersed among the nations, so they now look like all nations. They leave out the slavery part on purpose because they know that male slaves weren't allowed to mix with the free population. The only reason the women began to mix is because they were raped. But they leave that out and say Israel looks like everybody because they were dispersed into all the nations. They don't want to talk about the facts of slavery. The men weren't allowed to mix with the free women. Emmett Till again. The woman lied, but Emmett Till again. Couldn't even look at him. Couldn't whistle at him. Couldn't wave to him. Couldn't shake hands with him. Couldn't hug him. Definitely couldn't be in an open relationship with him. They still live as a distinct people. Now, we keep coming across this throughout history, is that they remain separate. If y'all go through and read the book of Nehemiah, I think it's Nehemiah, this mixed multitude got separated out. In fact, if we come over here to Nehemiah 13:13, we're going to start 13:1. I'm sorry, 13:3. So we're going to go 13:1 through 3 real quick, and we're going to read this because they like to play this mixed multitude game, that Israel was a mixed multitude, but they don't want to tell you that the mixed multitude was a mixed Hamite multitude of Cushites and Egyptians and maybe some other Hamites. They want you to believe that it was a mixed multitude that included Europeans and everybody else, which is a lie. Tell them to be very specific with which multitude came out of Africa. Watch them start tap dancing and running from the question. On that day, they read in the book of Moses in the audience of the people, and therein was found written that the Ammonite and the Moabite should not come into the congregation of God forever. So wait, they were marrying who? The Ammonites and the Moabites. Interesting. The Ammonites and the Moabites, the children of Lot. But wait, I thought Lot was the son of Abraham's brother, and Abraham was a Hebrew. So if Abraham was a Hebrew, why wouldn't his brother be a Hebrew? And then Lot had two daughters who were very likely Hebrews, because if his father was Abraham's brother and Abraham was a Hebrew, that would make Abraham's brother a Hebrew, which would make his children Hebrews. So Lot would be a Hebrew. I'm not saying Israel, I'm saying Hebrew. And then Lot's daughters would be Hebrews. And then Lot had children with his daughters, Ammon and Moab. The Ammonites and the Moabites, I'll say it that way. So they were Hebrews. They were Hebrew. They were Hebrew, little too much Hebrew. And yet the Israelites weren't allowed to mix with them, even though they were related. Because again, Lot was Abraham's nephew. Because they met not the children of Israel with bread and water. Oh wait, did it have anything to do with skin color? I know some of y'all think Israel wasn't allowed to mix with the other nations. No, Israel also wasn't allowed to mix with people who came from the same lineage. Why? Because they met not the children of Israel with bread and with water, but hired Balaam or Balaam against them, that he should curse them. Howbeit our God turned the curse into a blessing. Now it came to pass, when they heard the law, that they separated from Israel all the mixed multitude. They did what? They separated from Israel all the mixed multitude. Let me read it one more time. Now it came to pass, when they had heard the law, that they separated from Israel all the mixed multitude. The question is, did they go back to being a mixed multitude? And from what we read, Israel remained separate and they did not intermarry. We heard this from Claudius Buchanan when he talked about the Cochin Jews. We've read that in this source that they remained separate, and we read it in multiple other sources that they were separate. So what happened in Nehemiah? Again, they separated out the mixed multitude. So when you hear this doctrine of Israel is a mixed multitude, make them go to Nehemiah 13:3 and explain it. And when they explain it, ask them for the exact historical time frame when they started to mix into the other nations again, and ask them for evidence of this. We just don't see it. They still live as a distinct people, and yet they nowhere live according to their own laws. Nowhere elect their own magistrates, nowhere enjoy the full exercise of their religion. So when they ask you, what Israelites got off the boat practicing Judaism? Well, none. Because of slavery, they weren't allowed to just do what they wanted to do. Their solemn feasts and sacrifices are limited to one certain place, and that have been now for many ages in the hands of strangers and aliens who will not suffer them to come thither. Oh, wait, what? Come where? Are you talking about Jerusalem? Is Jerusalem in the hands of strangers that won't allow them to come there? Y'all look at the current news. Just see who's getting kicked out of Israel right now. See, we've been lied to for a long time, and we're going to force the conversation forward. There's nothing they can do about this. No people have continued unmixed so long. What? No people have continued unmixed so long as they have done. Not only of those who have sent forth colonies into foreign parts, but even of those who have abided in their own country. The northern nations have immigrated in swarms into the more southern parts of Europe, but where are they now to be discerned and distinguished? The Gauls went forth in great bodies to seek their fortune in foreign parts, but what traces or footsteps of them are now remaining anywhere? In France, who can separate the race of the ancient Gauls from the various other peoples who from time to time have settled there? In Spain, who can distinguish exactly between the first possessors, the Spaniards, and the Goths and the Moors who conquered and kept possession of the country for some ages? In England, who can pretend to say with certainty which families are derived from the ancient Britons and which from the Romans or Saxons or Danes or Normans? Hold on, let me pause right there. Because some people don't understand that in England, some of them are descendants of the Roman Empire. In many Christian circles, they teach a second Rome, or a second phase of Rome, the final kingdom, iron mixed with clay. And Chuck Missler believed that the iron mixed with clay may have referred to a kingdom mixed with Israelites, because Israelites are referred to as the clay and God is the potter. I'm the potter, you are the clay. And again, this is Chuck Missler's belief. I'm not saying it's 100% correct, but I just want to point out for those that don't know that some people in England were descendants of the Romans. Why is that important? Because the first Americans were English terrorists. Read the history. They were defined as terrorists, but they were English, and some of them were descended from the Romans. So the Romans had an empire that split up, and some of the Romans became the English, And then some of the English came over here and started a whole new country. So are we in the second phase of the Roman Empire, in which Rome and Israel are living together? We're going to get into the daughter of Babylon and Egypt and all that stuff. Even in America, witches of yesterday and a medley of European nations, the original stock is in many cases nearly obliterated in the lapse of less than three centuries. The most ancient honorable pedigrees can be traced up only to a certain period, and beyond that, there is nothing but conjecture and uncertainty. They were saying this in the 1800s. But the Jews can deduce their pedigree even from the beginning of the world. They may not know from what particular tribe or family they are descended, but they know certainly that they all sprung from the stock of Abraham. And yet the contempt with which they have been treated and the hardships which they have undergone in almost all countries should, one would think, have made them desirous to forget or renounce their original. But they profess it, they glory in it, and after so many wars, massacres, and persecutions, they still subsist. They still are very numerous, and what but a supernatural power could have preserved them in such a manner as none other nation upon the earth hath been preserved? You can say whatever you want to. We know the story of the Negroes that came from West Africa over to the Americas. We know the story of their descendants because we are them. We are walking, breathing, living Bible prophecy. But not only that, according to the author, the real Israelites are the light of the world that is also the proof of the scriptures and their divine inspiration from the Most High. And this is what those people in the black church and many in the white church, not all, this is what they're opposing. This is what they're fighting because they can't understand it. They want to believe that they are the protectors and guardians of spirituality. They want to believe they have a say in what's heresy and what's not. They want to believe that they are the gatekeepers of heaven, and they are not. They want to believe if there was a move of the spirit, they would feel it, but they don't. Their eyes are blinded. They want to believe they have been spirit filled this whole time, but something doesn't add up. God is making a move in the earth without them. Let me say it again. God is making a move in the earth without them. Hit that thumbs up button. Without them. Without their approval, without their permission, without their understanding. He is making a move. He is not using them in the way that they believe he would use them. He is not revealing to them in the things which they believe they have a right to be in on. What gives them that right, I don't know. Or what they think gives them the right to be in on a move of God, I don't know. But all I know is they have two choices. They can either get on the bus or they can get ran over by the bus. There will be no moving out of the way of this bus. You will either get on the bus or you will get ran over by this bus. The Most High is fully in control. He told the Israelites that the rocks would cry out if they wouldn't. So when the black church is putting God in a box saying God can't do this or he wouldn't do that or God wouldn't work this way, God can only speak through the Bible. God says, I'll show you. I'll speak however I want to through whoever I want to. Oh, you don't like these black people? That's who I'm going to use. I'm going to use all black people. And when I say all black people, I don't mean he will use every black person on the planet. I mean, he's going to use black people, Israelites, his people, to bring about change on the earth. And those of you who hate black people, you're screwed. Because see, God knows the heart. Ain't gonna be no hate and racist in the kingdom. So if you hate black people and you hate what God is doing with black people, you're screwed. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it. You are screwed. Because if the Messiah is black and you hate black people, guess what? You hate the Messiah too. He's not. He can see your heart. You can lie to us, but you can't lie to him. He can say, oh, wait, you hate black people, but you love me? Nah, let's stop. Let's stop playing games with these people. There is a spirit on the black church, and that spirit is not the Holy Spirit. That spirit is something else. This is why they oppose a move of God. They don't determine who is saved. They don't determine how God operates. They don't determine anything. God doesn't need them. God doesn't need anybody to do anything. He chooses to use certain people. And he has chosen not to use many of them. That's why many of them are sitting there blinded, because their heart is hardened toward the truth. They are nothing more than modern day mini pharaohs. Their heart is hardened. They don't want the Negro to be the people of the book, because they have hatred in their heart towards the Negro for no reason other than the fact that they want to hate us. To quote Chuck Missler, the hatred of Israel is demonic. And according to him, Hal Lindsey would say that it's from the pits of hell. All right. So now this source is out there. We're going to look for more. Shout out to the brother, Jesher Stevens. Let me make sure I had his brother's name right. I think it's Jesher Stevens. I wrote it down. Yes, Jesher Stevens. Shout out to that brother for bringing forth this source. And we're going to keep pushing. We're going to keep pushing this, and we're going to force the conversation into somewhere they don't want it to be. We're going to force them to own up to their lies. We're going to force them to own up to their deception. We're going to point out every time they've been wrong, because if they've been wrong this many times, people should not be looking to them as spiritual leaders, not even a little bit. Anyway, if you guys love this video, do me a favor, hit one in the chat. Also, do me a favor, click the thumbs up button. Make sure you subscribe, hit that notification bell, turn on all notifications, turn on your YouTube notifications. That way you don't miss anything coming up. And most importantly, share this video, because now we have proof that this has been taught for over 400 years. And anybody from this point on saying it's leaky camp doctrine is a deceiver, a deceiver. We're going to force them to drop the lies and narrative, or be exposed as liars and deceivers and devils. So yeah, now you guys have the source. Feel free to use it as you wish. Feel free to hard press these people when they come with these lies and deceptions. So again, if you want to support, hashtag BHITB anytime during the week. Or if you want to become a patron, go to patreon.com. With that said, till next time, I'm out.